Can I start speaking?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so good to be back again. Sorry from my side. My computer switched off suddenly and it restarted, and this didn't happen to me quite some time now. So there are two parts to my presentation. One is genetic engineering. Second one is precise genome editing. These two parts come from my career throughout. So genetic engineering, starting from TNA to my PhD. Then we have precise genome editing. So basically, this is genome editing in a precise way. That's my postdoc. The reason that I put precise genome editing is that genome editing today is not very precise. So I mean, that's the key area that I'm working on to improve, making the genome editing more precise. So if you see this map, so there are areas that are in green and there are areas that are in orange and red. So orange and red areas are those areas which have malnutrition. So if you look at majority of the places on Earth, so you have majority of the people are suffering from one or the other form of malnutrition. Whereas areas in the green are people in these are the areas in which people are well off, like they can get their enough nutrition through the food. So if you, I mean, the key message here is that we are looking at food security on Earth. So that comes from three components. One is productivity. That's how much food we grow. Second one is the quality and the safetiness of food. Then again, there is an important component to achieve, whether it is enough amount of food or quality or safe food. That's the technologies that we use. So food security, definitely, like, it depends on how much food we grow as well as quality food, but it also depends on the technologies that we create, which are which have an incredible impact on the food that people eat. So one of the first problem that I picked up to solve was to engineer plants with higher amount of iron and zinc, because not many people on Earth get enough amount of iron and zinc. Particularly, if you look at people who eat rice, they don't really get enough amount of iron and zinc. So, I mean, you will see that a lot of people who are suffering from iron and zinc deficiency are, they do come from the places on Earth where rice is a staple crop. So, the aim of my research was to engineer a rice plant that contains 14 microgram of iron and 28 microgram of zinc in the endosperm. This is because 14 microgram of iron and 28 microgram of zinc would be enough to support daily need of iron and zinc for a rice consumer. So the first experiment that we picked up was to engineer rice with a transporter called YS1. Idea was that having this YS1 transporter expressing plant means that the plant will be able to have higher amount of iron taken up and accumulated in the seed. But what we finally found was that indeed the plant was taking up enough iron and putting it into the seed, but the amount of iron that was in the endosperm was like 8 microgram, but we are looking for amounts that are much higher than this. So the second thing that we did was to see if we can engineer a plant that has higher amount of chelating compounds, such as nicotinamine and deoxymuginic acid. So these are compounds that bind to iron and zinc, as well as they will help in transporting iron and zinc throughout the plant and putting it into the seed. So what we did was to engineer rice with two genes, and which are nicotinamine synthase and nicotinamine aminotransferase. So these are two key enzymes in the nicotinamine and deoxymuginic acid compound synthesis. And what we found was that a plant that accumulates incredibly higher amount of iron and zinc, that is 23 microgram of iron and 84 microgram of zinc. So we have a plant that we are looking for. Then what we then investigated was to see if we can push forward to put more amount of iron and zinc in the endosperm, that is more than 23 and 84 microgram. But what we found was that there is an upper limit for how much amount of iron and zinc we put in the seed. That is, we cannot cross beyond 23 and 84 microgram in the cultivar that we were using. But maybe these numbers can differ from cultivar to cultivar. Maybe these numbers can differ from crop to crop. So what interesting was that when we put more amount of iron and zinc in the endosperm, so we create a situation where there is a competition in the endosperm for the space. So what happens is that when iron and zinc concentration goes up, we get 50% reduction in the cadmium levels. So meaning that we have a rice that can have higher amount of essential nutrients, but it can also have lower level of toxic compounds. So we looked at how much percentage of this iron is available for human absorption. What we did was to use a system called human COCO2 cell assay, which is an established system to assess bioavailability of compounds. So what we saw was that there was an increase in ferritin and transferrin levels in the cells that are treated with the transgenic line, suggesting that indeed plants that we engineered have higher level of bioavailable iron. So just to put this whole story in a simplistic way, so what we finally have is a single plant of rice that is engineered with six traits, which is higher level of iron, zinc, and more bioavailable iron and zinc, followed by low cadmium. Then we have a criteria here. We have a situation here, which is that since this rice has higher level of iron and zinc, so we will end up eating less amount of rice. So you know that eating higher level of rice can cause diabetes. So we will have lesser diabetes problem if we have to eat this type of rice. And again, since we are talking about a pathway that is helping in plant to transport iron and zinc, so this thing with the nicotinamide and deoxynucleic acid from this pathway helps plants to grow better in the problematic soil. So in total, this is like a plant package that we have with six different traits. So, I mean, it's incredible and it's like super encouraging, but what we are talking about is like rice is grown in Asia, but we have also problems in Africa. So what we did was to pick up a plant from Africa, which is corn, particularly white corn, because in Africa, people eat white corn for human consumption, whereas like there is a perception that yellow corn or other colored corn are for animal consumption. But white corn is known to have incredibly low amount of iron and zinc. So what we did was to take some of the knowledge that we gained from rice and engineer a plant, a corn plant, that can accumulate higher amount of iron and zinc. What was surprising to us was that along with iron and zinc, we also end up having higher level of methionine in the seed. So which is again essential nutrient for human beings, as well as like higher level of methionine containing food is incredibly valued in the industrial sector. But you know, like working with transgenics is like kind of it's difficult field if you are like working on applied aspects such as like engineering plants for human health or other aspect, because you know that most of those products may not see the field, or they may not necessarily get out of the lab. So most of the work that you end up doing like get stuck in the lab. So what we can basically do is to like create awareness in people by writing. So we did write about like creating awareness about like how good GM crops are and how like how the world can benefit from them. But you know, like I was like working on genetic engineering during my PhD, but that was around like 2013 to 2016 was like peak of my PhD. But on the other side, like we had a big event that was happening called genome editing. If you look at genome editing, this is like kind of picked up from the
Hello.
time. Hello? Can everyone hear me?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay. So I'll continue. So that was like the I would say one of the big reason that genome editing got a like a boost is because in many part of the world, genome editing is not considered as like a GMO technology, meaning that there is a separate type of a regulation. In most cases, depending on the context and how you edit the genome and like how much of editing you are carrying out, so the crops are not regulated in many countries. So for example, in US, genome edited crops are not considered as GMO, so you don't have to even apply for a deregulation or anything. So if you have a single base pair change to create a trait, you can simply take the product, take the plant, grow it in the field. And for example, if you want to like travel with a genome edited seed, for example, you take a flight or you take a bus or you take a car from New York to Minneapolis or New York to Chicago, you don't need to take any permission to take a genome edited seed or genome edited plant even. But if you are dealing with such a transgenic plant in many part of the world, you may not be allowed to take such a risk. So what I want to highlight is like genome edited plants are considered as like normal and like a normal plant or any crop that farmers grow in most part of the world. So India is kind of having like India has drafted its genome editing policy, but we'll have to see like what type of genome editing policy India will adopt. But if you look at overall picture for genome editing on Earth, so it looks quite promising given that many countries are considering them as normal and as well as many countries are showing openness towards the technology, so which looks incredibly promising. But is genome editing new? Genome editing is definitely not new. So genome editing has been there for a long time, right from meganuclease. We had then zinc finger nuclease, then TALEN, now the CRISPR. So I'm happy to say that I work in a lab that invented TALEN for genome editing. So now CRISPR-Cas. The reason that CRISPR-Cas got its incredible attention is because to build a TALEN construct, it takes at least 2 months if you are in a lab that works with TALEN construct design. And to build a zinc finger nuclease to edit a particular genomic site, it might take like 6 months of like construct building. But in comparison to any of the technologies that we are talking, so this is like CRISPR is like incredibly like easy because you can order a construct today and you can start a genome editing experiment in next 3 days, or you can order reagents today and you can do genome editing within 3 4 days without having to deal with the construct building. So coming back to like how CRISPR got invented, so again it came from Spain. I'm very happy because so what Francisco Mojica from University of Alicante in Spain found was that there is a mechanism in bacteria that destroys the virus. So what he found was that so when the virus invades the bacteria, what bacteria does is to take piece of DNA from the bacteria and have it as a memory. Then once the virus comes back, the bacterial system simply destroys the virus using the piece of DNA from the virus itself. So it's like viral neutralization system. But if you look at CRISPR, there are two main components. So what you have is a protein, then a sequence that is like a reference sequence which will find the genome that you want to cleave. So simply, it's a single protein plus an RNA molecule that will form RNA-DNA hybridization. Then in that RNA-DNA hybridization site, the protein cleaves. So it's incredibly simple. But once the DNA is broken, it has to rejoin, because the broken DNA means cell will not survive. But you know what happens is, like, cells simply use a system called non-homologous end joining, which is called NHEJ. So which simply creates like a couple of base pair deletion, or some cases you will have, like if you have a C here, you will get a C insertion. Sometimes, so this is called templated insertion. Sometimes you will have like the system copying the downstream sequences and inserting it. So this will create traits, because if you are looking at traits, by knockouts, so which is kind of an easy, but you will not be able to do a lot of things by simply like knocking out, but you will need a tool that will help you to perform much other tasks, such as like inserting a base. So what I'm showing here is, like, for example, I want to insert a G here, then like simply creating a deletion. I want to insert like three letters, not just one letter. But this can only happen when we provide that information using a DNA molecule, which is a double-strand DNA or single-strand DNA. And this information has to be copied, not inserted, but you know, it's like taking a photo, not like making a print. So you take a photo. So it's called homology-directed repair. So using the homology information, the repair system copies the information. So it's an incredibly difficult system, but this is an incredibly controlled way of doing genome editing, and also called, this is the precise way of doing genome editing. So this is the holy grail that everyone want to use in genome editing, that's doing genome editing by homology directed means. So I'll come back to this later on, but—
Hello, sir.
Hello.
Sorry for the interruption. There is a question in chat box. Would you mind answering it now?
Can we take the questions like once?
Yeah, sure. No problem.
Yeah.
We can.
Yeah, because, yeah. Then, so the first experiment that we did was to compare different CRISPR systems that are available today. So that's particularly, we have a Cas9, then we have Cas12a, which is like more predominant system for genome editing. The difference between Cas9 and Cas12a is that, so the guide sequence, which is an RNA sequence that will hybridize to the genomic sequence, is like 100 base pair, and it's also like two component system. Whereas in Cas12a, which is a very simple one, it's like a single RNA molecule of around 36 to 43 base pair. And second difference is that Cas9 can cleave the sites which has NGG-PAM. Well, there are enzymes that has like near PAM-less requirement, whereas Cas12a is more like it can identify and cleave a sequence that has triple TV, where V can be any base. Right? So these both enzyme systems allows you to edit different genomic context. So you will have sites that have NGG, you will have sites that have triple TV. So you can edit those sites using different enzymes. So what we did was to simply evaluate these different enzymes to see which one can perform the editing at higher frequency at a given site. So we picked up a site in rice PDS1 gene, which is again a gene from carotenoid biosynthesis pathway. And what we found was that, so all the enzymes that we were using can edit the site, but what we found was that the Cas12a edits the genome at higher frequency, and it has higher efficiency to edit genome compared to other enzymes. And what is also interesting to see was that if you look at Cas9, so it can make a blunt end cut in the genome. So what you end up having is like either few base pair insertions or a small deletion. Whereas in case of Castrol A, what you end up having is more of deletions instead of insertions, which are like more dominating in the Cas9 type. So what we concluded from our experiment was that, like, if you take different enzymes to edit, and if you have a chance to use Cas9 or a Castrol A, it's better to go with the Castrol A because it's more efficient. And then the second thing that we addressed was to see if we can capture tDNA at a cleavage site. The reason being that if you look at agrobacterium mediated transformation, so you have the tDNA that is launched and it simply is imported into the nucleus and it gets integrated in a random site in the genome. But what we want to do is like having a site in which tDNA can be inserted, right? So if you know a site, if you know a genomic location where you can get the transgene get integrated, so then you are quite sure that you don't have to screen like millions and thousands of plants, right? You can have like few plants, transgenic plants, and get a desirable phenotype. So what we did was to do a simple experiment in which we designed an experiment to insert the whole tDNA in the cleavage site. So here what we used was to cleave a promoter site near the promoter site and have a construct with hygromycin and the NASP terminator, but this construct doesn't have a promoter. So only when the construct is inserted in front of the promoter in the rice genome, you will have hygromycin gene getting expressed, and then you will have the plants that survive on hygromycin selection. So what we found was that when you have a construct without the promoter and try to insert that in front of the promoter, you get integration, which is like happens again at 4 to 5% efficiency. But what is important to see here is that, so what you see here in blue is the hygromycin construct. Then what you see here in the green is the genomic locus. So for example, if you take the first example, R288-12, so you have 43 base pairs of the construct deleted, as well as 35 base pair of the genomic site, which is getting deleted. Then again, you will see similar pattern. So the final like kind of summary from this experiment is that you can get the tDNA to get inserted in the genome using non-homologous end joining, but what you will end up having is like random deletion of the construct or the genomic DNA, so which is not desirable. So again, what I want to stress here is that, okay, you can like insert whole tDNA in a particular site, but you're not doing it in a precise manner. You are like randomly deleting sequences in the genome, so which might come, which can be detrimental. Then the third experiment, what we did was to see two different delivery methods. So one is DNA delivery by agrobacterium, and then we have DNA, RNA, and protein delivery, which can be done by biolistics. But since biolistics is not an efficient system, what we will have is like we will have CRISPR molecules that are delivered as protein, but we will have a selection system that is added, which is a selectable marker to score for it. So when we deliver CRISPR protein, CRISPR as protein, we will have a selectable marker plasmid to select for it. So what we will have is like we will score for editing events in the cells that received a selectable marker. So the system is quite simple. So we will have agrobacterium mediated transformation as well as biolistic mediated transformation, so which is kind of a standard way of doing things. Then what we will have is like plants that are regenerated. But to do this experiment, we picked up a gene called PDS1 from rice. Again, this is a gene from carotenoid biosynthesis pathways. This is a single copy gene. So if you knock out this gene, you will have a plant that is albino. So meaning that your experiment is going in the right direction. So you know that if you get an albino plant in the genome editing experiment using a PDS1, you know that, okay, genome editing. So you will only get a PDS1 phenotype if you have a biallelic knockout. So then, so if you have like 50, 100 plants or like 10, 15 plants, you see like albino plant and green plant. So you are sure that, okay, experiment is going in the right direction. So you are not like kind of wasting your time. So what we did was like, we used two different sites to evaluate these delivery methods. So if you look at CRISPR reagents, which are delivered as protein, so called as RNP molecules along with the selectable marker. So what you see here in the yellow is the plasmid molecules from the selectable marker getting inserted at the cleavage site, right? So these are like a small fragment of molecules, as well as we have like bigger fragments of plasmid molecule going into the cleavage site. Then if you look at biolistics method to deliver CRISPR as plasmid molecules, because you can simply purify the plasmid and deliver by biolistics. So you will again see that there are like fragments of DNA molecules getting integrated at the cleavage site. But if you look at agrobacterium mediated delivery, you don't see that is happening. You don't see like a broken DNA fragment getting inserted in the cleavage site. So this means that so agrobacterium is kind of a clean system to deliver DNA, whereas biolistics is like more of a raw system using physical force, which can cleave the plasmid molecules. So thus it can generate molecules for DNA repair. So when you have the DNA opened up by CRISPR system, so you have like biolistics to create small fragments of DNA which can be used for stitching in the broken DNA fragments in the genome. So, but if you look at, carefully look at the outcome of some of those insertion events, what you will have is like incredibly complex structures of small fragments. So for example, if you look at an RNP5, which is the second one, so you will have a blue, green, and a blue. So blue means a fragment of plasmid followed by genomic DNA, then there is a fragment of plasmid. So then if you look at fifth example, RNP18, so you have around seven to eight different fragments of DNA coming together and inserted inside the CRISPR cleavage site, inside the double strand break site. So this, I mean, if this happens over large scale, because you know the CRISPR can have off-target effect and it can cleave the DNA elsewhere in the genome. So if this happens at large scale, it will be incredibly difficult to clean up a plant to remove all those broken DNA fragments and have a plant with only single base pair or two base pair edited to commercialize them. But you know, like, but again, like different system have different advantages. What we found was like, if you deliver CRISPR reagents as protein molecules, you will end up having editing that was happening at single cell stage. So you can kind of predict what type of editing happened very early. Then you can also predict what type of inheritance pattern you are going to get. So what we have seen over a couple of experiments is that the RNP delivery is incredibly useful if you want to like edit a cell, then recover a plant, and you want to be sure that, okay, you have a particular type of edit which is going to be inherited in the next generation. So that's one of the advantages. Again, coming back to like whether broken DNA fragment getting inserted in a CRISPR protein plus a selectable marker delivery is kind of very specific to a crop. What we did was to investigate if this is like true for like other crops as well. So what we did was to edit a gene called MGFP5 in a GFP expressing Nicotiana benthamiana. So again, this is a GFP expressing line coming from University of Cambridge, and it's been used quite extensively in many labs. It's a single copy GFP expressing line. So what you see, for example, here is if you look at the GFP filter, for example, wild type, when you are having as a cali, you can see the GFP, whereas an edited cali doesn't show the GFP. So meaning that you can quickly score whether your experiment is going in the right direction or not, because like you don't have to like generate plans and then score for like editing efficiencies. But what's important here is the sequences that we found. For example, we have RNP 3.1-1, which is an event that we generated. So this plant has a 394 base pair sequence from the plasmid integrated at the cleavage site. Again, you will see several other examples where plants that were regenerated had integration of plasmid molecules from the protein plus selectable marker co-delivery. So what I want to convey here is like getting a fragment of plasmid molecule integrated in the cleavage site, that is the double strand break site, is not unique to a crop. It also can be seen across different species. What Pilistic can do is to deliver different reagents compared to Agrobacterium, right? Agrobacterium can only deliver DNA, whereas Bilistic has the capacity to deliver different reagents. So meaning that we can deliver a single-strand DNA or a double-strand DNA with the required information that we want to incorporate in the genome using Bilistics with the help of like delivering CRISPR reagents as RNP molecules. The reason being that, we kind of pushed this angle. We know that Bilistics is dirty if you use a protein plus a selectable marker, but if we can remove the selectable marker and deliver a single strand DNA and a protein, CRISPR protein, then what we end up having is a system that is considered completely a non-transgenic way of doing genome editing. So, there are several places on Earth in which how you do genome editing matters. So meaning that if you use the Agrobacterium mediated transformation, you have the tDNA sequence coming from Agrobacterium. So Agrobacterium is a pathogen. So meaning that these crops may have to go through regulation just because Agrobacterium being the pathogen. But if you can have a system in which you can deliver protein plus the single strand DNA to create traits, so then you are completely avoiding the transgenic regulations. So what we did was, so use the CRISPR as protein molecule, then have a single strand DNA molecule as donor with a particular genomic sequence that we wanted to incorporate to change the amino acid. So changing the amino acid in a particular locus allows the plant to tolerate a herbicide. So what we end up having is just by substituting an amino acid, we will end up having a rice plant that is tolerant to herbicide. So meaning that the genome editing and the repair has to go through homology directed repair in this system. Then we will have a plant that is herbicide tolerant. So we kind of repurposed the system towards homology directed repair by simply removing the selectable marker and incorporating a single strand DNA molecule that can cause that can help create the herbicide tolerant rice. And what we found was this herbicide tolerance is inherited to the next generation. As you can see here, wild type germinated on the herbicide doesn't grow very well, whereas the events that we created can grow very well on the herbicide containing media. But when you remove herbicide, all the plants remove, I mean, behave the same. But if you look at the homology directed mediated genome editing, which is again an incredibly precise way of doing genome editing that we say, so it's an incredibly low efficient system. So it rarely happens, and you can, the efficiencies can be incredibly, like it can be less than 1%, meaning that if you want to have one plant with HDR event, so you will have to like maybe like score hundreds and 200s of plants. So that's not efficient enough. So, but what we want to do is to improve homology directed mediated genome editing. So we identified that there are a couple of strategies that we want to follow. So one is manipulating DNA repair pathway. Then second one is like manipulating donor templates. Then third one is like adding new functions. And maybe like once we have like a couple of strategies that work, maybe we can combine those successful strategies and to have a cocktail of strategy which can be like designed. That's the combinatorial approach. So again, even the strategy-wise, we want to go a transgene-free approach. But what we want to use is a protoplast system. I'll explain why protoplast system, because protoplast system is like an incredibly efficient system. Incredibly efficient system. You can launch like bigger scale experiment. And this comes in handy when you are like a technology development lab, because like we are talking about like hundreds of constructs being evaluated over a week period of time. So this cannot be done by like, you cannot have this scale of experiment to be done by any other approach. So again, we want to get like kind of stick to what we do, that is transgene free genome editing, meaning that we want to deliver the CRISPR as protein, then we want to deliver the donor template as single strand DNA, then we want to deliver like different DNA repair proteins and chemical modifications on the donor templates as like as much as possible as non-transgenically. So coming back to the protoplast system that we have established, So if you take a leaf, particularly a tobacco leaf, so you can isolate like a million protoplasts. So meaning that if you have a million of protoplasts, then you can transform 10 to 15 constructs. So in a day, we can get like close to 10 million of protoplasts in our lab now. Then we have the capacity to transform almost like 35 to 40 different constructs. Then within 24 hours, we can evaluate them for their genome editing performance. So I mean, this is very important. This like high throughput approach is very incredibly important, because we want to see an answer as quickly as possible before making a plant or even a cali. So that we, like if the experiment fails, we can go back to the drawing board and design new strategy, design new construct, and come back again and evaluate them. So what we have now in the lab is an incredibly efficient editing system using non-transgenic genome editing platform, that is CRISPR delivered as protein molecules. So again, we have done this by using tobacco, that's by editing a gene called PDS. There are two copies of PDS in tobacco. So when you edit PDS, you get a white cali and a white plant, showing that, okay, experiments are going as planned. Then what we did was to see if we can edit another gene. So as I have shown before, then we have a line called 16C tobacco that expresses single copy GFP. Then what we have done using this plant is to make protoplast from this plant and deliver several different nucleases. We have seven different nucleases delivered, and We have tested them on two different sites. What we have seen is like overall, all the different enzymes show higher editing efficiency. But if you look at the nuclease G, that gives up until like 60% editing efficiency. So what I want to highlight here is that in the protoplast system, so you are transforming, let's say, 1 lakh to 2 lakh cells, of which you are, if you say you are transforming 1 lakh cells, so you are almost editing like 60,000 cells. So these cells can be grown and become plants. What I want to say here is that when you have a protoplast system and you use the non-transgenic means of editing, you can get up until 60% editing. So where you don't have any selection for to select for. For example, if you look at agrobacterium mediated transformation or a biologic mediated transformation, for example, if you take rice, you will have cells that are grown on hygromycin selection. If you take corn, you will have bilophos selection. Or if you take tobacco, you will have a kanamycin selection. But what you have here in protoplast system is that you don't have a selection at all, but you will still see an incredibly high number of cells being edited. Again, coming back to like how efficient is the system? For example, so since we edit a GFP gene, so this is coming from a single tissue culture plate where you will see that the green cali represents the cali that is not edited. But if you look at other cali that are not showing color, so they are all edited, meaning that you have more number of cali that are edited versus more number of cali that are not edited. Again, here there is no selection. You simply transform the cell and you grow the cells and make a plant. So this is like, this is again incredibly efficient. So if you look at nuclease E, so you see that out of the black bar that represents number of cali that are edited, and the blue bar represents the total number of cali that are formed. So you will see more than 80% of the cali that we recovered are edited in the non-transgenic means of editing. But again, if you go back here, so you see nuclease G has incredible high editing efficiency. Nuclease E is kind of like an average type of editing enzyme. But what you will see here is that when you have nuclease G, you have very less number of cells that survive. So meaning that this is an incredibly efficient enzyme, but maybe cutting anything and everything in the genome so that the cells are not survived. So whereas nuclease E is kind of an average enzyme that gives up like 30% editing, but you will see that maybe it is more precise and you will get incredibly high number of cells that survive, that survive and make a cali. So what we are currently going through is to establish this, the non-transgenic means of editing genome in soybean, tomato, canola, potato, pennycress, cetaria, rice, and corn using the protoplast system. But you can ask a question like, can every protoplast be regenerated? For example, corn, you don't see an example of protoplast being regenerated. Whereas rice, you know, rarely people have regenerated. There is a laboratory in Japan that can regenerate rice from protoplast. Cetaria, for example, which is like a C4 model, we don't have a regeneration system. But you can regenerate plant from protoplast in tomato, canola, as well as potato. But soybean, you can't regenerate. But you know, like things, it's a problem not to regenerate, but definitely, you know, someone will find an answer how to regenerate from the protoplast. So what we are trying to address now using our protoplast system is to like evaluate several different strategies for doing homology directed repair mediated genome editing, which is like the crux of what the crux of experiments that we are doing. I would love to like give a sense that it's not that easy to do homology directed repair. That's why, you know, it's like incredibly low efficient as well as incredibly like not many people have achieved like greater progress in this front. But what we are trying to like do now is to like see if we can improve the homology directed repair mediated genome editing by delivering different proteins for that are involved in HDR repair pathway, as well as to see if we can inhibit the non-homologous end joining pathway by using several chemicals that can be like used to inhibit several proteins in the NHEJ pathway. We are like currently in the process of like evaluating different donor modifications. There are like several chemical modifications that can be utilized, as well as like we are trying to create the capacity within the CRISPR enzyme to see if we can deliver the template DNA to the cleavage site. And again, we are also looking at using a system called SunTag system to see if we can improve the homology directed repair mediated genome editing by using a recruitment system. And again, like the reason the homology directed repair is like incredibly low efficient is we are looking at a cell type that we use in tissue culture, which is a somatic cell designed for having non-homologous end joining mediated repair dominance. So we want to see if we can manipulate the cell cycle and whether we can improve the homology directed repair mediated genome editing. So in a nutshell, the summary of our experiment, like what I have done so far is like, so we have successfully engineered several crops to have like important nutrients, but you know, like these crops are stuck in the lab because again, the global GM regulation doesn't allow these crops to go off from the lab to the field. And what we have shown is like, we can edit genomes using different delivery platforms, using particularly the non-homologous end joining repair pathway. And what we have also shown is like, we can use the HDR mediated genome editing in crop plants at a lower efficiency. But what is like had to be done is to design and design a system where we will have like incredibly high efficient homology directed repair mediated genome editing. And what I want to also highlight is that the global regulations on GMO are not really like unfair, but what we would like to see more is like the GMO genome editing is like not kept in the box of genetic modification. For example, what's happening in the Indian regulation is like, I think the genome edited crops are again dealt within the genome genetically modified organism box. So I think what's important is to like treat them separately and keep them in different boxes. So with this, I think I would like to thank a lot of people here. So I think this is the first time I should be like, I'm thanking Dr. Sudhakar while he is present. And so everything started to me from TNAU, particularly from the transformation lab, as well as like, I would like to say that there were a lot of people who were like incredibly helpful. I worked some time in Dr. Mohan Kumar's lab, as well as like Uday Surian sir was like incredibly helpful. And I know that Dr. Robin is not anymore with us, but whenever I went to the paddy breeding station, he has been like incredibly kind. Then like I would like to thank quite extensively my PhD supervisor. He's like he has been like incredibly helpful in guiding me throughout my career. And I also want to thank my postdoc supervisors, Dr. Khan Wang. She's been very kind as well as helpful. And my current supervisor, Fang Zhang, he's an incredible supervisor. So I would say it's in his lab that I started to build technology. Whereas in many other labs, I used to use the technology to create traits. But I have to say that, I mean, it's incredible to work with him. Like taking problems to create technology. I think that's been, I know that it's not that easy to build a technology, but it's definitely like an incredible space to be in, so that, you know, like you are always learning and you are always moving to look at new things as well as to create new things. So thank you all for being. So these were the plans that we created, me and Dr. Sudhakar created when I was in TNU. So these were like the plants that we had in the greenhouse. So we had like a full greenhouse of plant, a lot of plants. So still, I think the seeds are in the growth, in the cold room, I guess. So thank you all again. Thank you for listening. So if you have any question, so I'm kind of free. So you can have me answering your question for a long time. So I don't have like a time limit. I don't have anything else to do now.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for your nice learning how we can use genome editing technologies to improve crops. We have few questions in the chat box as well as from YouTube.
Let me look. Let me look. I'm not quite used to this. So how can I get
to the chat box? Read for you, or you can, if you can ask the participant to directly ask also.
Yeah, how about that? So that they will also get a chance to introduce.
Yeah. So Godwin, I'm unmuting you. Ask your question.
Hi, thank you, sir. Thank you very much for the talk. I am also alumni of TNIU. I'm from CPMB as well. I'm doing PhD now in Ireland.
That's cool.
Yeah, I see also Sudhakar sir and also Nyanam and Mohan Kumar sir is here also. Yeah. My question is, have you checked the macronutrients or micronutrients to see if there is a trade-off? Because I see in your slides, can you go to your slides from maybe the one where you showed about the zinc content was increased? So have you checked of nutrients if there is like increase in the iron and also the zinc content, if there is any trade-off of other nutrients?
Yeah, definitely there is a trade-off.
Okay. Yeah.
So definitely there is a trade-off. It's not like a rosy picture. So again, so we are people who are trying to design, right? So there is trade-off, but you know, like over the year, someone will answer them.
Okay. Thanks. So the next question is, do you have a reason for the decrease in content? It looks like it's a very significant 50% reduction. So do you have any reason for that?
So again, like zinc and cadmium are competing elements.
Okay. So
the proteins that take up zinc also take up cadmium, mm-hmm. as well as like there are like transporter that take up iron also take up cadmium. So when you have a system that helps to put more zinc, so you kind of suppress the cadmium transport.
Okay.
Yeah. That's the reason. So zinc and cadmium are competing elements. So mm-hmm. it's particularly because of the zinc that you end up having lesser cadmium.
So yeah.
What these people have shown it before.
Okay, sir. Okay. Clear. So I had like other some questions maybe I can ask now itself.
Yeah, sure. Yeah, you can.
So the other question was about the nuclease, the last one you were showing about the efficiency of the different nucleases. Yeah. So have you checked any the off-target effects of these specific nucleases? Looks like nuclease E is very
yeah.
and so, do you think it's because of the gas system is working well or?
Yeah, so what we have done like kind of a smart thinking. So what we have done is to like edit the off-target itself.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So what we see is that nuclease G like edit the off target as much as like it can edit the on target. So it's like it is like incredibly efficient, but at the same time it is like incredibly promiscuous, so it can like randomly edit genome. So it's that's the reason that you end up having like incredibly high editing efficiency, but you also have like compromised off target editing.
Okay. I haven't worked much on CRISPR yet, but I was thinking if we have like three different genes And then you, if you want to like do single mutation in those genes, and if you use like, for instance, your system, RNP delivery system, if you do that, how fast you can generate the plant? Or maybe there is one more question, and also how...
Yeah. Okay, let me answer this. So RNP, so it's incredibly good.
Okay.
So again, I would advise you to design construct and like use like Agrobacterium or a ballistic delivery, because mm-hmm. like if you are a student, it's also important for you to design constructs.
Okay.
Mm. Okay. So yeah. RNP is like when you are in like when you are like in a place where you are kind of like looking at technology to improve, then you know like so for us like editing genome right now is like we don't consider it as like big thing, right? So we like kind of use RNP delivery, mm-hmm. but and this has like incredible applications in the industry, mm-hmm. but for someone in the academia, it's important to learn how to do. So I would like highly advise, because it's easy to buy things and like simply deliver.
Mm-hmm.
It's also important to like design constructs. It's like it takes a lot of time, it takes a lot of like learning to design construct. And it's quite helpful to you as a scientist in the future days.
Yeah, maybe at some point I'll contact you.
Sure. Yeah.
Yeah. Thank you.
There is a next question by Kajal. Kajal, if you are there, you can ask your question. Hello, Kajal. Okay, I'll ask the question, sir. Hello.
Hello. Yeah, please.
Yeah. So if NHEJ is considered as error-prone way of DNA repair, then why we are using that? There is an advantage.
Okay. Over HDR. You can ask it.
I'm not listening properly. Can you please ask again?
Yeah. 1 minute. So the question is, why we are using NHEJ over HDR? Is there any advantage?
So we are not using NHEJ over HDR. It's just the cell that you edit, use the NHEJ.
Okay.
So it's a default system in a somatic cell.
A question from YouTube.
Yeah, please.
Genome editing takes for crop improvement.
How many days depends on the crop. Again, like if you take rice, for example, you can have an edited rice cell within 3-4 hours, for example, then you can have an edited rice plant in 50 days.
Okay. Then another question from Dr. Sudhakar, sir.
Yes.
Do you observe the complex DNA integration of cleavage site in Agrobacterium delivery?
We haven't observed the complexity, but I would like to admit that it also depends on how you screen. For example, what we did was to amplify like a 1 kilo base pair sequences. So that's like if you have a double strand break site, so we have 500 base pair from the upstream and 500 base pair from the downstream. But if you look at the Agrobacterium delivery, you normally deliver a bigger cargo. So meaning that the screening method we have adopted might have missed those complex rearrangements. So that's my guess, as well as like there are like other people who have published now showing that you do get like fragments of DNA coming from Agrobacterium delivery, which is arranged in a complex way at the cleavage site. I think one of the problem with like genome editing analysis is like we tend to like amplify. If you look at like next generation sequencing, so you get to like amplify 200 to 400 base pair. So there is no way that you can amplify a bigger fragment, which is normally delivered by Agrobacterium. Again, like if you look at like genomating screening by amplifying a fragment and cloning it into a plasmid. So you are normally dealing with like 600 base pair or 1 KB. So again, you are missing the bigger fragments that can be integrated at the cleavage site.
Okay, sir. Thank you. There is one more question from Harita.
Yeah, please.
The session was amazing. My doubt is that after genomating, prolonged resistance will be there in plants or not?
So when you say resistance, what type of resistance? Like
could be maybe like some insect resistance or tolerance.
Maybe for example, like hygromycin resistance, you're developing a construct.
I mean, like if you take up a crop like rice, I mean, you are growing cells on hygromycin selection. Then you will have hygromycin resistance like durable for a long time. But like, again, like but you are not looking to use genome editing to create like a resistance of like a hygromycin or anything. For example, if you look at genome editing to create herbicide tolerance, I mean, your tolerance will remain because the genome will be edited. But you know, maybe there can be autocorrection. Like if you are looking at a single base pair change that you have created, and the cell DNA repair machinery normally like works all the time, then it can be possible that like if you say you have introduced A or T, maybe it might get corrected later. There is definitely that chance. Again, like if you have a trait, whether it can be durable, definitely it can be durable. Then like answering this question from another perspective, for example, if you look at human beings, when CRISPR proteins are introduced into human cells, so there are like resistance mechanisms to fight against the CRISPR itself. So maybe there is like a mechanism, resistance mechanism in the plant that can fight the CRISPR system.
Okay, sir. Thank you. One more question from YouTube. Is genome editing possible for wild crops? I mean, like forest crops like eucalyptus?
Genome editing is possible wherever you can deliver the reagent. Okay. So if you, for example, on a theoretical basis, if you have a sequence of any crop, sequence of like any organism, let's say, not just crop. So you can simply have a guide RNA, then have a CRISPR protein and deliver it by agrobacterium and edit. No, deliver it by biolistics, not by agrobacterium, sorry, and edit. So you can even simply like take a leaf of any crop that you have, and you can definitely transiently edit that by biolistics. Then if you have like a capacity to do protoplast, then you can edit it by protoplast. But only tricky aspect is like whether you can edit a crop or any plant by agrobacterium. That depends on whether the agrobacterium can infect that wild plant or any plant. So if that cannot be infected by agrobacterium, so again, you will find an answer over the years how to make the agrobacterium to infect a particular cell or a particular plant. So for example, people didn't know how to infect corn with agrobacterium a couple of years ago. Now we know how to infect. People didn't know how to infect like rice early in the 1980s with agrobacterium. Now, you know, like agrobacterium mediated transmission is like a major way of doing transmission in rice. So any crop, if you have a sequence, yeah, you can definitely edit.
Question from my side. So I'm a bioinformatics graduate student.
Yeah, please. So
in what, like how bioinformatics can contribute to this field of plant genome editing, like any tools which we can use?
Bioinformatics has a like big role. I mean, so if you look at genome editing, so it's basically like genomics. So like for example, if you can come up with like tools to predict more precise genome editing outcomes, as well as like if you can come up with tools, for example, if you have a guide like what type of repair outcomes that are going to happen, that's going to be like incredible, right? For example, there are so many crops in which you don't have a capacity to design guides. So for example, you asked eucalyptus, right?
Yes.
So there is no software that allows you to design CRISPR experiments. So you can design that, right? So that's the capacity of bioinformatics. So bioinformatics is like incredible powerful tool for like genome editing. So I think it's like the core of genome editing, I would say.
Yeah, there are some tools like Synthego, which does help us to design guide RNAs.
Yeah, and there are like other examples. For example, integrated DNA technologies, Synthego. Then you have like CRISPR RGN. Then you have CRISPR Espresso from MIT. CRISPR RGN is from South Korea. So there are, like you have like range of tools to design guide. But definitely, like if you want to have like a guide which you know that more precise, for example, you can do it in RISE because you have genome sequence available, then as well as like the whole, for example, barley, if you take. So there are many softwares available to design guides, less after-get guides or something. But I haven't seen, for example, a tool that allows guide RNA design. Maybe there is one, but maybe I haven't come across the softwares that I have used. I don't see a genome editing platform, bioinformatic platform for like groundnut. Let's say coconut, for example. So again, there is like huge scope for like including those things. As well as like if you can like create simulation for homology directed repair using different like bioinformatic tools, then that will be like you can have like 1,000 different strategies. So if you can simulate and evaluate 1,000 and come to like 10 best scenarios, that's like quite helpful to evaluate 10 than 1,000.
In that note, I want to ask a question. So you showed like you used like nearly like 3 to 4 guide RNAs to target the genome locus. And do you think that multiple guide RNAs specificity or to target the genome, or would have you also used like a single guide RNA to target a genome sequence?
Yeah, so again, so when we used single guide RNA, for example, one of our like Agrobacterium experiment, I can show somewhere it is. Yeah. So this one. So like we got like 90 to 100% editing, meaning that so when we have like 20 events, so 20 of them were edited using a single guide. As well, like the cases where we have seen more editing efficiency by using multiple guides was when we had CRISPR delivered as RNP molecules along with the selectable marker. So you know, this happens by a condition. So you are looking at a cell that received selectable marker, then you have CRISPR as protein delivered, and this protein has a short life. Then you have a chance that there are several cells that receive only selectable marker, not the CRISPR. Then you have like cells that receive only the Cas9 protein, not the guide, but selectable marker along with this. So there are like several possibilities, right? But if you have like more guide RNA delivered, like to edit single gene, if you deliver like 10 guide RNAs along with Cas9 protein and the selectable marker, then you have a chance to improve editing efficiency by like protein delivery. But to improve editing efficiency by Agrobacterium, I think like by using a single guide, we have seen like incredibly high editing efficiency. But there are other people also who have, like they have shown that using multiple guides, you can like boost the editing efficiency, but you also end up having another problem there. More guides means more off targets.
That is the thing I wanted to ask you. Yeah.
Yeah.
So have you tried using DCAS9 system as well?
Yeah, that's for like activation. So I haven't worked on activation, but there are several colleagues of mine who are working on activation. Mm-hmm. You don't see, like DCAS9 doesn't edit the genome. It's just like sits on the DNA.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Binds to the DNA. Then like, since like CRISPR is like an DNA unwinding system, then like just by unwinding the DNA, you might cause like changes in the transcript of a gene.
Do you think like genome editing technology in the future also would come under the GM regulations, or would it bypass that rule?
In many places, it's not considered as GMO. I'll have to see like how India will go through. The current regulations that are put in place for public comment are kind of fair to genome editing as a technology. But, you know, like again, like policy framing is not that easy. So like they will have to budge to many people who are not scientists. So we will have to see like how it will go through. But as far as like many of the places on earth considered now, so like for example, US, you don't necessarily have genome editing as GMO. And even in Argentina, for example, I think I heard that Philippines and Thailand are having an incredibly liberal policy towards genome editing.
I think Nyanam ma'am has a question. Pranav, can you unmute her?
Ma'am, you can ask your question.
Yeah. Hi, Ravi, Raj, how are you?
Hi, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am. How are you?
Yeah, I'm fine. Genome editing and generation of haploids, I think already in few of the laboratories, people are working on that. Any notable achievement in any of the crops that has come out?
Like genome editing by using haploids?
In generation of haploids, you know, CRISPR with SYNH3, there is a, any comments on that?
I've read that paper. I think
okay.
It came from Syngenta, okay. I guess.
Okay.
I don't remember exactly, like back of my mind.
Okay.
Yeah. But you know, like I think, yeah, like whether genome editing can be used for like generating haploids, I think it's doable.
Yeah.
Okay. Like Syngenta has done it. You know, there's a Nature Biotech paper on it.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you.
I think there is another question. Is it possible to apply genome editing in perennial crops?
As I said, any cell you can edit as long as you can deliver the reagents. Rice is perennial.
Yeah. So can you just say like a little bit about your future plans on how you're going to take on this project, maybe just in brief, it's not very confidential. Yeah.
I think the future, definitely, I'm more inclined to improve the precise way of doing genome editing. That's where the fruits are, because that will allow us to have a capacity to create desirable changes, not just random changes. Again, for example, if you want to like engineer a pathway in a particular locus of the genome, then like that can be only possible by homology directed means. That's definitely one of the key direction that I want to work on. And second direction that I would like to take is like improving the technology further, so that you know like creating new technology helps other people to utilize it. So like I want to improve genome editing platform in itself. Then the third one is like, again, I want to like kind of keep a little bit on the basic science of like creating traits. That will be like lesser of a focus, but definitely like improving genome editing as a technology to make incredibly precise genome editing will be the key area that I will be I'll be working on.
So would it be like a great idea to edit different pathway genes at the same time rather than stacking them and artificially engineering them?
What do you mean?
There were papers on like stacking of different genes, from Paul Christoph's lab some years ago, right? So would it be nice to edit using genome editing to actually simultaneously develop, if not to engineer, but to just like edit those pathway genes and to see what happens in the product?
I think I'm kind of more interested. I mean, to me, like editing pathway and editing like gene to create traits is like, it interests me kind of a lesser than like creating the technology.
Okay.
For example, if I can add a function to CRISPR, is more interesting to me than like editing a gene in a pathway, because that's like the tools are available to do that. But
you are basically creating the tool, the technology for the further research or doing the application of
it. Yes.
Got it. Yeah. So Sudhakar sir has a question. As the genome editing edited soybean.
You can ask.
Yeah.
Hello Pranav, can you unmute him? Yeah. I unmuted. Sir, you can ask. Hello, sir.
Hello. Yeah, I'm here. Yeah. It looks like he has a problem from his end.
So maybe Pranav, can you ask the question?
Yeah, he's can't use mic. So his question is, has genome editing genome-edited soybeans that is approved in US undergone genome sequence to prove no bits and pieces of DNA?
I'm not quite sure if I know it, if I know it completely, that it doesn't have bits and pieces of DNA. I think I can ask someone who is involved with this, because the genome edited soybean came from the Talon based technology. So I can ask someone, like my supervisor was involved in designing that genome edited soybean. So I can ask him, but I'm not quite sure whether it was required to provide the whole genome sequencing to prove that there were no bits and pieces of DNA. Again, I just want to mention, I think in the beginning, it was not of a major focus to do whole genome sequencing to see you have bits and pieces of DNA in the genome before commercialization. But if someone have heard about the bulls that were hornless bulls created by a company called Recombinetics. So what they had was that they had a bull that was ready for farmers to grow, but at the end what happened was that they submitted sequence, and then someone from the regulatory authority blasted that sequence in the NCBI, and they found out that there was a plasmid molecule that was integrated in the cleavage site. So it became it was blown away everyone. Then this happened last year, and this happened right before we published our paper in Scientific Report. So now I think it's compulsory that people have to provide the whole genome sequencing information which was not the case, I think, before. But I may be wrong. But definitely, like, now it is, like, it's important that people provide whole genome sequencing information before the commercialization.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for your wonderful session, sir. And I would like to ask Vimanam ma'am to give the vote of thanks. Hello, ma'am.
Excellent lecture for with more of explanation, and take it from me, this is the greatest return investment you can give to your alma mater. As usual, so there is no need to there is no second thought. I'm always proud of the LLB school members. They are very active at all the time and in sharing the information, even in editing the lectures and the topics. The constant and stable supports in organizing several kind of webinars through LLB school. Thank you, Divya, Magesh, and Pranav, and the whole team, whoever is responsible in organizing this. I thank all the participants for taking interest in participating.